Hare Krishna. Welcome to the last day of this series on those 18 days, where we've discussed the events on each of the days of the Kurukshetra war and the lessons that we could learn from them. Today, we will discuss the climactic battle on the 18th day. That was the battle between Bhima and Duryodhana. On the 18th day, the Pandava troops were upbeat and the Kaurava troops were demoralized. Their depleted ranks tried to fight under Shalya, who fought to the best of his capacity. But Yudhishthir soon killed him. And Shakuni was killed by Sahadev, as he had vowed. And seeing practically all his warriors and almost entirely all his soldiers killed, Duryodhana fled. He went and hid under a lake using his mystic power to stay there. The Pandavas discovered him and challenged him to come out for a final fight. He was very sarcastic. And he said, initially, he said, I'm not coming. The Pandava said, why are you hiding here like a coward? Yudhishthir primarily called out to him. Come out and do your duty as a warrior, fight. You were the person who caused this war. And it is because of you that so many warriors have died. Now, why are you hiding from the war that you started? So Duryodhana, his pride angered, said, I'm not hiding, I'm just tired and I'm resting. You also rest, and in due course, I'll come and fight you. Yudhishthira said that we have all rested enough now. Don't give any excuses. Come out and finish this war that you started. Duryodhana replied, everyone that I lived for, all my friends have died. Karna, Shakuni, Dushasan. I have no desire for the kingdom. Take it. I reward it to you. Yudhishthira didn't miss the note of sarcasm in his voice. And he said, oh Duryodhana, you have no right to give this kingdom because it was never yours to give. You are the person who caused this war by your repeated atrocities. If you really wanted to give a kingdom, give the kingdom. Why did you reject Krishna's proposal by saying that you would not give enough land even to put the tip of a needle through? Do not be a coward and avoid the war that you have started. And Duryodhana said that, I'm alone, I'm weaponless, I'm armorless, and you are many. I can fight you. But how will it be a fair fight? Yudhishthira replied that, yes, it is you who remember fairness when you had ganged up with several other warriors to kill 16-year-old Abhimanyu. Yet, I will grant you a fair fight. Come out and fight with whoever you choose. If you defeat even one of us, we will all accept defeat and you will be the king. Krishna looked with concern at Yudhishthir. Duryodhana was an extremely powerful mace fighter and practically no one could defeat him. Maybe Bhima could defeat him, but even that was not sure. Bhima was stronger, but Duryodhana was better in skill. He had been trained by Balaram, who was by far the best mace fighter. So, at that time, Duryodhana came out of the water and he said, I do not care with whom who among you I fight with. I can defeat all of you. And just wait for an hour and all of you will be destroyed. Choose, let whoever wants to come, let all that person come one by one and fight with me. I don't care. Now, It was because of his arrogance that Duryodhan didn't choose a weaker opponent. He hoped that Bhima would fight because he longed to kill Bhima. And Bhima leapt forward and he said, "Yes, I will destroy your pride and I will end your life today." Balaram appeared at that time, and all the assembled warriors offered their respects to him. And then, as he heard quickly the narrative of what had happened while he had gone on pilgrimage, then he, along with all the warriors, went toward Simant Panchak. That is a place where Parshuram had performed austerities. It was a very sacred place, and they had decided to have a battle over there. The warriors formed a circle, and in the middle of it were Bhima and Duryodhan. Bhima hit his bow, his mace, with such force on the ground that the earth seemed to shake. Duryodhan raised his fist, shaking it forcefully, glaring with unbridled hatred at Duryodhan, at Bhima. Soon the fight began. The celestials assembled in the sky to watch this climactic fight. As both of them kept fighting, soon Duryodhana's superior skill started giving him the upper hand. Bhima hit him with repeatedly with force, and yet Duryodhana would block or dodge or side dodge or otherwise defend himself. And he was counter-attacking. And several times he hit Bhima severely. Bhima also landed in a few blows. But the Pandavas could clearly see that Bhima was getting battered. Eventually, Duryodhan hit Bhima so severely that Bhima was shaken, although he did not show himself being shaken. And then Bhima swung his mace and hit Duryodhan so forcefully that Duryodhan was knocked off his feet and hurled quite some distance away. Now, when Duryodhana had hit Bhima, he had hit him straight on his forehead, and Bhima started bleeding, and Duryodhana had expected that Bhima would fall. Bhima would be so wounded that he would not even live, or even if he lived, he would be severely injured. And Bhima was wounded, but Bhima, with a stoic face, showed no pain at all, and he kept himself ready to fight, and that shook Duryodhan. It took him aback. What kind of opponent is this that I hit such a blow and nothing happens? And that's why he did not follow that attack with a second attack. And seeing Duryodhan's temporary pause, Bhima took that opportunity and hit Duryodhan. And as Duryodhan fell to the ground, he initially screamed in pain as he was hit. But as he got up and shook off the dust, he found that he was utterly uninjured. And he started smiling the sadistic delight. And he started sneering. Bhima was shocked that blow had been big and forceful enough to actually cause a hill to break apart into pieces. How had Duryodhana remained utterly unscathed? Arjuna approached Krishna and he said, "Oh, Keshava, what do you think will be the outcome of this fight? Who do you think is superior?" Krishna thoughtfully replied that both of them are more or less evenly matched. But while Bhima's superior strength can match Duryodhana's superior skill in normal times, these are not normal times. Why were they not normal times? The previous night, Gandhari had come to the camp. When she had heard from Sanjay how all her sons had been killed except for Duryodhana. She saw that, thought that I will keep him alive some way or the other. And she gave him benediction by which his entire body, all the parts of the body that would be vulnerable in a mace fight, they were invulnerable. So his body had become tougher than mountain. Nothing could damage it. Nothing could destroy it. And Krishna said, because of Gandhari's blessing, Duryodhana has now become undefeatable. That has given him an unfair advantage. Now to understand how unfair this advantage was, let's compare this to a cricket match. Normally in a sport like cricket, the bowler bowls and the batsman bats. The bowler sends the ball and the bowler has to somehow get the batsman out and the batsman has to score runs. Now the ways in which the batsman may get out is the batsman may be clean bowled, or the batsman may be leg before wicket, the batsman may be caught, or the batsman may run out. Now if it's specifically the bowler going to get the batsman out, then there are a few ways, the three ways: getting caught, getting leg before wicket, or getting bowled. Now suppose a particular batsman gets a blessing. There is a change in the rules of the match by which the batsman will never get out. That means even if the batsman misses the ball and the stumps are shattered, if all three stumps fall, still the batsman is not out. Even if the batsman blocks the ball with his feet, still the batsman is not out. If the batsman hits the ball and somebody catches, even the batsman is not, then the batsman is not out. On the other hand, there is no such change of rules for the bowler. The bowler bowls, and when the bowler is hit, it can be a boundary, it can be a sixer. And now the bowler can go on bowling and bowling and bowling and bowling. And it's just a match that the bowler can't win, no matter what the bowler does. The bowler may bowl the best spell of their entire life. Leave alone their entire life, the bowler may bowl the best spell in the history of cricket. And yet the bowler has no chance to win at all. The bowling is laborious work. Actually, it's far more exhausting than batting. Run and hurl the ball with great speed again and again and again. Now, as the bowler is bowling and the batsman is never getting out, when the batsman is hitting, the bowler is getting exhausted. This was the predicament of Bhima. Bhima was doing everything in his power. But the whole basis of mace fighting is that using the mace blows, you injure the opposite person. Now, Bhima broke the armor of Duryodhan very quickly. Duryodhan also broke the armor of Bhima during the course of the fight. But once the armor is broken, the body is normally vulnerable. And the body's vulnerability is the opportunity for either side to win. But if the body is rendered invulnerable, how can one possibly win? So a player will become exhausted. So Bhima was getting exhausted. And he was also getting wounded because Duryodhana was hitting him. And Duryodhana's blows were hurting him. Whereas Bhima's blows were not hurting Duryodhana. And Bhima had his hurt Duryodhana and he had screamed in pain. It was more from the severity of the blow and anticipation that he would be injured than actually he being injured. He was hurled through the air and that was alarming. But when he fell and he noticed, looked at his body, he was unwounded. Now, Duryodhana hit Bhima several times and twice he hit Bhima so severely that a lesser warrior would have been immediately killed. Somehow Bhima sustained those wounds and kept fighting. But it was a match which Bhima was, in one sense, destined to lose. It was fixed against him so that he could never win. And just by the power of time and the wounds that he would sustain, eventually he would lose. So go back to the cricket metaphor, when Duryodhana hit Bhima repeatedly, it's like the batsman, when the bowler is bowling, the batsman is using the bat to hit the ball back and hit the bowler itself again and again and again. So the bowler is getting battered, not only the bowler exhausted by the ball being smashed to the boundaries, but the bowler is getting wounded by the ball being hitting at him. So similarly, Bhima was at one level thwarted completely. He was not able to wound his opponents. He was getting wounded. What was he to do? So this was a fixed match. And it was unfairly tilted toward Duryodhana. So now, this match, if Bhima had to have a realistic chance to win, he had to unfix the match. And Krishna is always the protector of his devotees. So Krishna knew what Gandhari had planned. And just as earlier, when Bhishma had got 5 arrows to kill the Pandavas, Krishna had asked Arjuna to go and get those 5 arrows from Duryodhana. So similarly, Krishna decided to intervene, and he intervened himself over here. The Gandhari had arrived at the Kaurava camp, and she had told Duryodhana that you bathe and come to meet me in the condition in which you were when you were born. Now, in cultured society, you may not use word like completely unclothed, the N word for that. So she just said, come in the way in which you were naturally born. And Duryodhana was a little puzzled, but he said, okay, it's my mother. If that's what she wants, I'll do that. So he went to bathe in a nearby river. And at that time, as he was returning by, he saw Krishna over there. He said, what is Krishna doing over here? And Krishna started laughing. He said, Duryodhana, where are your clothes? He said, actually, my mother, Duryodhana was himself embarrassed. And when he saw Krishna laughing, he became even more embarrassed. Actually, my mother has told me to come to her like this. Yeah, I mean, she said that come the way you should. Well, that doesn't mean that you should even expose your private parts. At least cover those. At least put a loin cloth around your private parts. And Duryodhana thought, and he said, okay, that makes sense. So he put a loincloth around his private parts, and he came to meet Gandhari. Now Gandhari, by her mystic powers, she would plan to make Duryodhana's body invincible. She had performed great austerity. In general, austerity means not indulging in pleasure even when we can. So just seeing the world at one level is pleasure. Through the eyes, we can see so many attractive things. So Gandhari had voluntarily accepted blindness when she had been married to a blind man, Dhritarashtra. And she had put a blindfold on her eyes, a cloth to cover them. And she never removed them. She never saw, even for the few times that it was removed while she was bathing or she was replacing the cloth. But this time, when Duryodhana said, yes, I'm here, she removed her blindfold, and at the same time she opened her eyes and she looked at Duryodhana, and all the mystic power that they had accumulated by her austerities, not just by accepting voluntary blindness, but by any other austerities she had performed during the course of her life. She was a religious lady, although she unfortunately happened to be on the evil side, and she was attached to people who were evil. But still, she had powers, and she invested all those powers in her eyes. And as she glanced at Duryodhana, she made his body entirely invincible. And then as she was looking over his entire body, she suddenly noticed that loincloth. She said, what have you done? I told you to come the way you were born. She said, actually, Krishna told me to put this loincloth around me. Oh, Gandhari felt dejected. She had done her best. She had invested all her mystic powers. And now she couldn't do that again, she said. My desire was to make your entire body invincible. Now, however, that part of your body will remain vulnerable. Now, initially, Duryodhana had not been very sure about whether Gandhari's protection would even work or not. But when he had seen how he had been utterly unhurt by Bhima's deadly blow, he became delighted. He had just been given the winning card. And now, although he knew that the portion of around his thigh was vulnerable, he didn't bother. Because according to the codes of war, codes of mace fighting, one is not supposed to hit below the waist. And when the match had been about to start, Duryodhana had told Yudhishthir, you are celebrated as Dharmaraj. You know the codes of Dharma. So you should be a referee and make sure that nobody violates those codes. And that was like a coded way of saying that you should make sure that Bhima doesn't hit me on the thighs. So now, if we consider that Duryodhan had got something extraneous which had made the battle tilted toward him, biased toward him. So then, for restoring fairness in a match that had unfairly favored one person, something had to be done. And Krishna had made a two-step plan to restore fairness to a match by countering the unfair advantage with the opposite party had got. So Krishna initially ensured that the portion under his thigh was, the portion below his waist, around Duryodhana's thigh was vulnerable. And now, as Arjuna and Krishna were discussing, Krishna told Arjuna that because Duryodhana has an unfair advantage, Bhima needs to use the appropriate strategies. While fighting wicked enemies who have unfair advantages, even unfair strategies can be used. In fact, Indra used famously unfair methods to defeat Virochan and Vritra, the demons who had otherwise been terrorizing the gods and even the universe at large. So Krishna gave precedence also. And understanding Krishna's words, Arjuna caught Bhima's eye as he was circling at a distance, and while he was fighting with Duryodhana, and Arjuna tapped his thigh, and he understood. Bhima understood this must be some plan of Krishna. Bhima himself had been pondering, how can I win this match? You know, Bhima had been hit twice, deadly blows, and he was fast weakening, although he kept utterly stoic demeanor, showing no pain at all. But he was in pain. He was diminishing in strength. He knew he couldn't fight for very long. And although Duryodhana had been battered, he was unaffected. So although he was exhausted, he was not wounded. So Duryodhana had a big advantage for him. And as they kept fighting, again, they slowly but surely, Duryodhan seemed to gain the upper hand as in this round they kept fighting. And Bhima, using an opportunity, swung himself round and hit in a full blow Duryodhan. Now, Duryodhan, expecting that move, leapt up. Now, when he leapt up, as Bhima's blow swung, now what happened was that Bhima's blow exactly hit Duryodhan on his thighs. So, Avasthan was the specific move by which one shifts out of position and or leaps up and dodges the blow. So, in this case, Bhima hit Duryodhana on the thighs and such a blow. Now, Bhima's mace was so powerful that so heavy, in fact, that it took three men to even lift it, or to speak of, actually wield it. And Bhima had charged forward, so he was rushing forward, and he had the force of both his mighty arms. And when it all that combined force hit Duryodhana on his thighs. Duryodhana's thighs cracked. Everybody could hear it. It was like a thunderbolt cracking a tree. Duryodhana shrieked in pain and fell to the ground, writhing. It was clear to everyone that the battle was over. Bhima celebrated in victory. Duryodhana, although he was in pain, he was incensed. He said, "You have won only by unfair means. Do you think I didn't notice when Arjuna signaled that you should, when signaled touching his thigh? It is only because of this wicked Krishna that you have forgotten the codes of morality. It is because you have, only because you have fought unfairly, have you won this war. There is no glory in your victory. There will be only infamy. I will attain heavens because I have fought heroically and have died a hero's death. Whereas you will be condemned forever." At that time, even the gods in the heavens seemed to agree with what Duryodhana was saying. And Krishna at that time spoke firmly. And he said, "Oh Duryodhana, you blame me now. But it was I who came to you to ask for peace on the most accommodating terms. Why did you reject it at that time? Where was your sense of fairness at that time when you refused to give the Pandavas their fair share of the kingdom? Where was your sense of fairness that you ask for now when you rigged the gambling match and stripped Yudhishthira of his kingdom? Was it out of fairness that you tried to poison Bhima? Was it fairness because of which you tried to burn the Pandavas along with their aged mother alive? Was it out of fairness that you, along with five other warriors, ganged up against Abhimanyu and killed him?" So, as Duryodhana heard this, he remained defiant. He paid no attention. But it's important here to note that what had Bhima done? Bhima, to go back to the cricket bowling example, what can a bowler do if a match is rigged so that the batsman never gets out? And maybe the only way is to get the batsman retired hurt. Just bowl at the batsman's body and injure the batsman. Normally that's not fair. But in an unfair match, what's fair? So Bhima did what he had to do. And we see that although the match was unfairly biased against Bhima, Bhima did not choose to attack below the thigh as his first option. So Bhima knew that. So Krishna also spoke this and he said, "Because of your arrogance in disrespecting the great sages, you were cursed to have your thigh broken. Bhima has only honored the word of the sages." So Bhima could very well have used this excuse. "I am an instrument for the actualization of the sage's curse." But he did not do that. He did not choose that as first course of action. Bhima could have said that, "I have taken a vow to break your thigh because this was the thigh you invited." Draupadi, a bear had bared his thigh and said, "You come and sit over here, Draupadi." So he could have said, I have taken a vow to break your thigh and I would do that. But Bhima's plan had been to defeat Duryodhana fairly, and he had tried it to the fullest extent. His plan was, "I'll defeat Duryodhana fairly and then I'll break his thigh." But when the match had been unfairly biased against him, he did what he had to do. So, if you look only at the immediate picture, yes, what Bhima did seems outrageously unfair. But if you look at the bigger picture, then we see that Bhima did what he had to do. Bhima had to survive and win in a match that was unfairly biased against him. So law codes or war codes cannot be seen in isolation from the overall way the war has been fought. And Bhima in this way illustrates, although he was powerful, he illustrates his submission to Krishna's supreme wisdom. And the Mahabharata's great virtue is that it is throughout The whole Mahabharata is motivated by the question, what is dharma? And dharma is subtle, dharma is sukshma. It is not easy to understand. And the Pandavas' choices at various times can seem unfair. Bhima's choice in hitting Duryodhana below the thigh can seem definitely unfair, but it is not. What is dharma? Dharma is not just legalistic, following the rule of the law to the letter. Dharma is fulfilling the purpose of the law. And the purpose of the law is ultimately that the virtue should rule. Those who are vicious should be sidelined and neutralized. Otherwise, they will spread adharma in the world. The Pandavas were following dharma because their purpose was dharmic. And that dharmic purpose, how to fulfill it in the real world when fighting against people who are vicious, who have repeatedly exploited others, who have no sense of ethics. How to function in the real world is demonstrated by the controversial incidents of the Mahabharata. As the Mahabharata is a book that offers us real guidance in real life. Not that we treat this as a license for us to play hard and fast with any and every rules, but that we don't become so rigidly fixated on the rules that we forget the purpose of the rules. We remember the letter of the law, but more important than that, we remember the purpose of the law. This is a lesson that we can carry among the many other lessons that the Mahabharata is ready to teach us. So in this series of those 18 days, we just took some small incidents from the Mahabharata and we analyzed some of the wisdom that we can glean from it. The Mahabharata is an oceanic book and there is this oceanic wisdom that can be learned from it. And I hope that this series will inspire you to explore the wisdom of the Mahabharata, the wisdom of the epics, the wisdom of the sacred texts that form the Vedic canon. With this, we conclude the series. I wish all of you auspicious journey in your life, guided and empowered by the wisdom of the Mahabharata. Thank you. Hare Krishna.